Hello students, in the previous sessions we have discussed production of iron and steel in different furnaces. So we have discussed production of pig iron from blast furnace and the construction of blast furnace and what is the charge for blast furnace and what are the products and byproducts of blast furnace and how this pig iron is made and what are the operations that took place in the blast furnace and what are the reactions that will support the operation. All these things we have discussed, and later we have discussed the production of wrought iron in a puddling furnace, as pig iron is not suitable for industrial applications, so we have to refine it for the application of industrial applications. So later we have discussed construction of puddling furnace and the operation of a puddling furnace, the reactions that took place in a puddling furnace, and properties of wrought iron and applications of wrought iron we have discussed. And we know that wrought iron is the purest form of iron and which can be used in many industrial applications. And later we have discussed production of cast iron from cupola. So here we have discussed the construction of cupola and the operation of cupola, and what is the charge for the cupola furnace, and what are the reactions that will takes place in the cupola furnace to get cast iron. So later we have discussed the properties of cast iron and the applications of cast iron in the previous sessions. And after completion of these irons, we entered into production of steels. In production of steels, first we have discussed production of steel in a Bessemer converter. So how the construction of a Bessemer converter will be, and how many types of Bessemer converters are there, and what is the process that will take place in a Bessemer converter, and the construction and the operations involved in a Bessemer process we have discussed. And later we have classified basic Bessemer process and acidic Bessemer process, and we have classified the differences, and we have differentiated the basic Bessemer process and the acidic Bessemer process. So what are the differences between a basic Bessemer process and a acidic Bessemer process we have discussed elaborately in the previous sessions. And we have discussed the applications of steels that is made in a Bessemer converter, and why we should go for basic Bessemer converter compared to your acidic Bessemer converter. What is the difference and why, what is the advantage of going for this Bessemer converter we have discussed. Later we enter into production of steel in a LD converter. Okay, so what is the difference between a LD converter and your Bessemer converter? So how the construction will be, and what is the difference between your Bessemer converter and the LD converter, and how the lining of the refractory material will be, and what are the different impurities that can be removed off by using this LD process. So the constructional details, the operational details, and the reactions, all these things we have discussed in the previous session. And later we have discussed the characteristics of LD steel. That means the steel that is made in a LD converter is having good characteristics. So because of those characteristics, we are going to use that steel in different engineering applications. So those things we have discussed, characteristics of LD steel and the applications of LD steel in engineering applications. So these are the things we have discussed in the previous sessions pertaining to production of iron and steel. Okay, so our chapter is production of iron and steel. In this one we have discussed these many processes till now: production of pig iron from blast furnace, production of wrought iron from puddling furnace, production of cast iron from cupola, and production of steel by using a Bessemer converter, okay, either basic Bessemer converter or acidic Bessemer converter, depends on the impurities present. And later we have discussed LD process for making steel and characteristic of LD steel and applications of LD steel. So these things we have discussed in the previous sessions. And today what we are going to do, we are going to discuss manufacturing of steel by open hearth process. Okay, so these things we are going to discuss in today's session, that is manufacture of steel by open hearth process. I will show you here. See, so we are going to discuss how steel is manufactured in an open hearth process, and what is the construction of a open hearth process, and what are the operations that will take place, and what are the reactions. Those things we are going to discuss in this one. So if you go for the previous session, so already just now I told you, in the previous session we have discussed the Bessemer converter of steel making and LD process of steel making. These things we have discussed elaborately in the previous sessions. Now we are going to discuss this one, very important one. See here, on completion of this session, what we are going to able to learn, we are going to learn the principle of open hearth process and basic open hearth process and acidic open hearth process. I already told you, already we have discussed this basic and acidic. When we will say basic and acidic, based on the learning material for your Bessemer converter. So how, when we can call it as basic open hearth process and when we can call as acidic open hearth process in this open hearth furnace, so we are going to discuss. Okay, coming to the subject, the principle, if you see here, so what is the principle? If you see here, principle of open hearth process, very important question in the examination. Principle of open hearth process, if you see here, principle of open hearth process. Open hearth process, open hearth furnace will operate on a preheated fuel gas and air. Preheated fuel gas and air. So this furnace works on the preheated fuel gas and air. So that means the gas that entering into the furnace will be preheated and the air is also preheated. So we should remember this one. So open hearth furnace will operate on preheated fuel gas and air. The fuel and air for combustion are preheated in the checker work of regenerators. So here we are using regenerators for, by using this regenerators, what we are having, we are, so the fuel and air for combustion, which are used for combustion, are preheated by using these regenerators. So by using these regenerators, what we are going to use, we are going to heat your fuel and air, which are going for the combustion process. So they are preheated before combustion process only, they are preheated and they are sending into the furnace. That one we have to remember. So first thing what we have to remember, we are using preheated air and gas. So how they are preheated? By using regenerators. Before combustion only, the air and the fuel are preheated and they are sending into the furnace. So regeneration depends on passing of waste products of combustion as they leave the furnace through a chamber containing checker bricks, which becomes heated by these waste hot gases. So how this regeneration, that means how this preheating will occur? See here, regeneration depends on the passing of waste products of combustion. After combustion, you are having some waste products and waste gases. So those things, so those are going to leave the furnace. So before going to leave the furnace, what we are doing, that means we are sending through a chamber containing a checker bricks, and which heats the your gas and air. That means your fuel gas and air will be heated because of these waste products of combustion. Because of this waste products of combustion, preheating will be done. So what we are using, we are using the waste products of combustion, that is the regeneration. Because of this regeneration, what you are going to do, you are heating the fuel gas and air. Okay, so these two points you have to remember. First, preheating is done, okay, to the fuel gas and air. How the preheating will be done? By using a regenerative method. So what is mean by regeneration? Regeneration is nothing but whatever the waste products of combustion will be evolved from the furnace, those are used for the heating purpose. So this is regeneration method. By using this regeneration method, we are heating the fuel gas and air, that is preheating of fuel gas and air. So these three points you have to remember and you have to write in a beautiful sentences. And next, after an interval of flow of gases is reversed so that the gas and the air enter at opposite end of the furnace, whereby they are preheated before entering the furnace. So if you see here, after an interval of flow of gases, so you are sending the flow of gases inside, and later what will, when you reverse the direction, what will happen? The gases will preheated and they enter into the furnace. So in this way, your preheating will be done. See here, after an interval of flow of gases is reversed, so that the gases and air enter opposite end of the furnace, whereby they are preheated before entering the furnace. So in this way, so when the waste products of combustion are reversed, that means they are coming towards this air what we are sending. So because of that heat, what will happen? This can be heated. So preheating will be done before this fuel gas and air enters into the furnace. So in this way, we are going for the preheating of the fuel gas and air. Okay, so these four things you have to remember. First, in open hearth furnace, what we are doing, we are using preheated fuel gas and air. So how preheating will be done? So preheating will be done by using regenerators. Okay, so by using regenerators, we are going for the preheating of fuel gas and air. So what is meant by this regeneration? Regeneration is nothing but when the in the furnace, when you are having these waste products, because of the combustion waste products, you are having some heat energy. Those heat energy can be utilized for preheating of your fuel gas and air. So when the direction of the air is reversed, when the direction is reversed, when the direction of the hot gases that is evolving from the waste products of the furnace, then they are reversed, what will happen? The gas entering into the furnace and the fuel gas will be preheated before entering into the chamber. In this way, we are doing the preheating operation. So this is the main principle of open hearth process. See here, what are the essential features? So what are the, how the construction will be? If you see here, how the constructions will be, if you see the constructions, so the essential features of the furnace are a valve system where the flow of gas, air and waste products of combustion can be reversed. See here, just now I told you, we have to reverse the flow of gas, air and waste products of combustion can be reversed. That means if you want to change the direction of flow of air or fuel gas or the combustion of waste products, you have to reverse. Because of that one only, we are going to get regeneration, and because of that regeneration only, preheating will be done. So you have to have a system of arrangement such that the flow can be reversed. The flow of air and fuel gas and your the combustion of your waste products can be reversed. Okay, you should have such arrangement, then only this regeneration is possible, and because of this regeneration, your preheating will be possible. And a regenerating system whereby air and fuel can be preheated. So if you are having this system, then you will be having a regenerating system. Because of that regenerator system, what you will be having? You are having your air and fuel can be preheated before entering into the furnace. It consists of shallow of hearth with the back wall. So hearth, in this where the molten metal settles, that is hearth. So you are having a shallow hearth with a back wall, doors in the front wall. So you are having doors in the front wall and roof over the top. Okay, so the arrangement, the constructional arrangements, if you see the construction, so how the construction of a open hearth furnace, if you see the construction, how the construction will be, you are having a, see here, you are having a, see here, you are having a shallow hearth with back wall and doors in the front wall, and you are having a roof over the top. So you are having a roof over the top, and you are having back wall and you are having front wall. Okay, so in the back wall, in the front wall, you are having the doors. Okay, And the opening of one end is to allow the passage of heated gas and air which burns. So you are having at one end, you are having opening. From that opening, you are sending the heated gas, preheated gas and air, and which can be used for the burning process. Okay, if you see here, so how the construction of a open hearth furnace. So in an open hearth furnace, we should have a system, we should have an arrangement such that the flow of gases and air and waste products, that means the waste products of combustion. So whatever the waste products, after combustion, you are getting some hot gases. Those directions should be reversed such that you should get regenerative effect. Because of this regenerative effect only, what you are going to get? You are going to get preheating. So if you want to get preheating, then what you have to do? You have to an arrangement which can reverse the direction of your flow of gas, air and waste products of combustion. Because of that, regeneration is possible, and because of the regeneration only, your preheating is possible. So such that here you are having a regenerator system. Because of this regenerator system, your air and fuel can be preheated. So before entering into the furnace, it can be heated. And if you see the construction of a open hearth furnace, if you see the construction, it is having a shallow hearth, and you are having back wall and front wall. On the front wall, you are having the doors, and you are having a roof on the top. Okay, this is the main construction details of a open hearth furnace. And the opening at one end is to allow the passage of heated gas. So you are having an opening from that one. What you are having? Your hot gas, your preheated gas and air can be enter into the furnace, and which is used for the burning process. Okay, so this is the constructional details of a open hearth furnace. And if you go for another points, see here. See, the other opening allows the burned gas to escape into the chimney via the regenerator. See here. So this is very, very important. So before entering into the chimney, the products of combustion, what they will do? They will enter into the regenerative system. Okay, because of the regenerative system only, what will happening? The preheating will occur. So if you see here, the other openings what we are having allows the burned gas to escape to the chimney. So before going to chimney, what it has to do? It has to enter the regenerator. That's my via. Via only. That means the openings of burned gases should enter to the chimney via this regenerator system only. Regenerative system only, it has to enter into the chimney. Okay. So by entering into the regenerative system only, it will enter into the chimney and that allows the burned gas to escape from the furnace. So I'm repeating. So how the hot gases will escape from the furnace? So before they will enter into the chimney, they has to travel through the regenerative system. This regenerative system is used to preheat the fuel gas and air that is going to enter into the furnace. Okay, so for that purpose we are having this regenerative system. So that's why it will not enter, that means the products of combustion will not enter into the chimney directly. It will enter the chimney via your regenerative system. And shallow hearth and the walls of the furnace are lined with basic refractory material, generally magnesite bricks. Okay, so the lining will be basic refractory materials, and the roof does not contact the slag and hence made with silica. The roof will come in contact with the slag. So here it is made with silica irrespective of the process. Whether it is acidic process or basic process, we will made with silica. Why? Because whatever the slag that is forming after impurities, oxidation, that will not come in contact with the roof, so there is no need of go for another material. This silica is sufficient. The charging materials are placed on the hearth of the furnace through the charging door. So from the front you are having, from the front wall, for the front wall what you are having charging doors. That means you are having doors. From the charging doors, what you have to do, you have to keep the charging materials into the furnace. Okay, so this one, these are the different steps. I'm repeating once again. See here, whatever the products of combustion that will enter into the chimney, they will not enter directly into the chimney. They should go via regenerative system, and later they will enter into the chimney. First point. And the second point, you are having a shallow hearth, and the walls of the furnace are lined with basic refractory material, generally magnesite bricks. And you are having a roof at the top. The top will not come in contact with the slag. Okay, so whether it is an acidic process or a basic process, the top will be made with silica only, because the whatever the slag that is forming, it may not come in contact with your top. So there is no need to use another material based on your process, whether it is acidic or basic. So whether it is acidic or basic, we can use silica only. Okay, and the charging material, how the charging materials are placed. Just now we have discussed the front door is having door. Sorry, the front wall is having doors. So from that doors, from that charging doors, we are going to keep the charging materials into the furnace, generally on the hearth. Okay. So these are the constructional details and operation details generally of your open hearth furnace. See. So the order of charging materials in the furnace is quite important. So first, which one you are charging, and later which one you are charging, that is also important. It is very, very important. So the limestone which has flux is charged first. First, what we have to charge? We have to charge limestone, and iron ore, which acts as oxidizer, is charged over the limestone. And the limestone ore protect the hearth from damage during the charging of scrap, and which allows after iron ore. Okay, so what is the order? So in which order we have to charge it? So first, what we have to charge? Limestone, which acts as flux. Later we have to add iron ore, which acts as oxidizer. Later we have to add scrap. Because why we are adding this scrap later? Because when you add scrap at the initial stage, what will happen? The scrap may damage the hearth surface. So to avoid that one, first we have to charge with your limestone, later with your iron ore, and next we have to add scrap. Later you have to add scrap. So in such way, what will happen? See here, to protect the hearth from the damage during the charging of scrap, so which allows after iron ore. So after iron ore only, we have to add this scrap. So finally, pig iron is charged. So this is the order. First one, what is the first one? What is the first one you have to charge? Limestone. And what is the second one you have to charge? Iron ore. After iron ore, what you have to do? You have to go for the steel scrap. After steel scrap, then you have to add pig iron. So 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so you are having 1, 2, 3, 4 things here. So this is 1, and this is 2, your iron ore, and this is limestone is 3, and your, sorry, not limestone, I will tell you one by one. So your limestone is 1, and your iron ore is 2, and your steel scrap will be 3, and your pig iron finally added, that is 4. So this is the sequence we should follow while charging the open hearth furnace. Okay, so first you have to add limestone, later iron oxide, and next steel scrap, and last finally you have to add pig iron. See here. See, so this is the construction. This is the construction of a your open hearth furnace. If you see here, this is the hearth. So this is the hearth portion. Okay, this is to chimney. Okay, you are sending to chip. Okay, this is the air we are sending. Okay, see, gas and air are led to the bath through one big and set chambers, and the spent gases then pass through the checkers in the other set of chambers in order to heat them. That means whatever the products of combustion we are getting, they should not be allowed to escape into atmosphere by chimney. First, they have to enter into the regenerative system. By entering into regenerative system only, they has to reach the chimney. So because of that one, what we are going to get, because whatever the heat we are having in the process of combustion, the heat can be utilized for preheating the gases that we are sending into the furnace. So in this way, we are doing the preheating process. See this one. So this is your, this is to chimney. This is to chimney, and we are sending heat. Okay, you are having regenerative system. When the first have to cool, the directional flow is reversed. So when the first have to cool, the directional flow is reversed. That means when it is cool, then what we have to do? We have to reverse the direction. So we have to reverse the direction. When the direction is reversed, what will happen? So the regeneration process will take place and preheating will occur. See this one. This is very, very important diagram. If you see here, this is very, very important diagram. If you see here, so this is your hearth. This is your hearth area. This is your hearth. And if you see here, you are having a charging door. You are having a tapping hole here. You are having, if you see, this is a regenerator and this is a regenerator. You are having two regenerators. I already told you why we have to reverse the direction. Okay. If you see here, this is to chimney and we are sending the gas from here, and this gas is entering from here. So you should have an arrangement here such that the direction can be reversed first. So first I am sending the gas. So initially first stage, in the first stage, what I'm doing, I'm sending the gas here. From here I'm sending the gas. So the gas is moving in this way. These are the checkers, that means regenerators. So whatever the gas, because of the heating gases, what is happening here, this chamber will be hot. So when you send the gas, what will happen? Preheating will be done and it will enter into the furnace. Okay, after some time, what will happen? This will become cool. So what we have to do? We have to change the direction. We have to change the direction. When your air is moving in this way, what is happening? Your exhaust products are coming in this way. So this chamber will be heated. So when I reverse the direction, what will happen? Your combustion products will come in this way. Your combustion products will come in this way and your air will enter into in this way. So what will happen? Your air will be heated here and this chamber will be heated again. After some time, what will happen? It will be cooled and it will be heated. So then you have to reverse the direction. So in this way, so you should have an arrangement such that the direction of flow should be reversed. Then only we can have here regeneration is possible and here also regeneration is possible. So because of this changing in the direction of flow, we can have regeneration in both the chambers. Okay, so first stage this one, and later when it cools down, then you have to go for here, second one. when this cools and here again, and when this cools here again. So in this way, it is a repetition process. So you have to have an arrangement such that the direction should be reversed. Okay, so this is the main construction of a open hearth furnace. See here, the charging of materials into the furnace through the charging door, just now we have discussed. Limestone is charged first. I already told you. So first, what we have to charge? See here, limestone should be charged first. Later, iron ore, which has acts as oxidizer. After iron ore only, we have to add some steel scrap. After steel scrap is added, we have to add pig iron. We have to add pig iron. Okay. So first limestone should be added. Later iron ore should be added. After adding iron ore, we have to add steel scrap, and later we have to add pig iron. So heat comes from the burning of fuel directly over to the hearth. Okay. So in this way, the operation will take place. So whatever the things we have discussed here, what things we have discussed here? So what is the sequence of charging of material? So first, what we have to charge? Whatever the charging door we are having, from that one we have to charge. You are from the for the front door, what you are having for the front wall, you are having a door, charging door. From that one you are going to charge the charging materials. So the sequence of charging materials is, first you have to charge limestone, and later you have to add iron ore, and after adding iron ore you have to add steel scrap. After adding steel scrap, what you have to do? You have to add pig iron. You have to add pig iron. Okay, so in this way, this is the sequence of adding charging materials into the open hearth furnace, and your whatever the heat comes from the burning of fuel, that will directly reaches the hearth. See, heat is reflected from the refractory roof, thus creating reverberatory action. So all these things, this one already we have discussed. What is meant by reverberatory action? What is meant by reverberatory furnace? So reverberatory furnace, if you see the reverberatory action, you are having a dome shaped roof. So when the heat touches that one, it will reflect back onto the hearth. So this process is known as reverberatory action. So it requires 2 hours for the charge to be practically to molten state. In 2 hours, the complete charge, whatever given, it will become molten state. The oxygen comes from the iron oxide or iron ore, and silicon and manganese being oxidized and oxygen of ore. And later, carbon monoxide is evolved by the oxidation of carbon and causes a violent agitation of metal. So you will be having some sound, violent agitation, some sound and some vibration type will take place, some agitation will take place because of this carbon monoxide evolved by the oxidation of carbon, causing a violent agitation. And this one is known as, this phenomenon is known as ore boil. So in the examination they will ask, what is meant by ore boil? What is meant by ore boil? When the carbon monoxide is evolved by the oxidation of carbon, in that process, what will happen? A violent agitation of metal will take place. This phenomena is known as ore boil. Very, very important question. Okay. So this one, very, very important one. This one is very, very important one. What is meant by ore boil? What is meant by ore boil? When carbon monoxide is evolved by the oxidation of carbon, during that process, what will happen? Violent agitation of the metal will take place. This phenomenon is known as ore boil. Okay. So if you see here, you are having a reverberatory action. You are having a dome roof, a dome shaped roof. Because of that roof, when the heat touches the roof, it will be reflected back onto the hearth, and it took nearly two hours for the charge to be practically to reach the molten state. and the oxygen comes from the iron oxide, and silicon and manganese are been oxidized from the oxygen ore, and carbon monoxide evolved as the oxidation of carbon causes violent agitation of the metal, and during this one violent agitation will take place, and this phenomenon is known as ore boil. Okay, later we will see some more points regarding this one. Okay, if you see the next points, limestone is decomposed to lime and CO2 gas. So what are the things will happen in the operation? See here, limestone is decomposed to lime and CO2 gas, and phosphorus form into slag and a phosphate, and boiling of the bath is stopped at the moment when the deoxidizers and alloying additions are introduced. So boiling of the bath, so just now I told you boiling will be occurred, so the boiling will be stopped, and when the boiling is stopped, then you have to add the deoxidizer and other alloying elements if needed. After the holding time, the hole open to tap the metal. After holding time, that means you have to keep for some time, and later you have to tap the molten metal. Okay, so your limestone is decomposed into lime and CO2 gas, and phosphorus form into slag and a phosphate, and boiling of bath is stopped. When the boiling of bath is stopped, you have to add the deoxidizers as well as the alloying elements if needed. And after the holding time, after certain time, so you have to keep for certain time. After that time, what you have to do, you can tap your steel. Okay, so these are the operations that will take place in the open hearth furnace. So what is meant by acid open hearth process? So hearth of furnace is lined with acid refractory material. So it is similar to your Bessemer converter. So what is basic Bessemer converter and what is acidic Bessemer converter? Here also, hearth of the furnace is lined with acid refractory material. Then we can call it as acid open hearth process, and charged with low content of sulfur and phosphorus. So when you are having low content of sulfur and phosphorus, then you have to use this acidic open hearth furnace. Solid pig iron is charged first, allowed by scrap, and oxidation occurs during the melting. Slag of manganese oxide and silica together with iron oxide is formed. So your manganese and silica, the impurities, your manganese and silica will be eliminated here. When desired amount of carbon remains in bath, ferrosilicon may be added to the bath in order to arrest the oxidation of carbon. So when you are having required amounts of carbon, then you have to add ferrosilicon such that the oxidation of your carbon can be arrested and you should get required amount of carbon. So these things will be happen in the open hearth, acid open hearth process. Basic open hearth process. If you see the basic open hearth process, so in basic open hearth process, what we are having, basic open hearth process is generally used for the production of steel for a wide variety of works at least cost. So when we will go for this basic open hearth process, this basic open hearth process will be used when you are having sulfur and phosphorus impurities are more in the charge. That means in your ore or in your charge, if you are having phosphorus and sulfur are more, then we have to go for this basic open hearth process. So the steel is used for girders, wire, ropes, and other general structural purposes. Okay, so this is basic open hearth process. Everything, every process will be different, only the lining will be different, and here you are eliminating phosphorus as well as sulfur, whereas in acidic open hearth process you are having acidic lining, here you are having basic lining. In acidic open hearth process, it is not suitable when you are having phosphorus and sulfur contents are more. So when we'll go for HD open hearth process, when you are having phosphorus and sulfur are less in content, then only we will go for the HD open hearth process. So here in HD open hearth process, we are eliminating only manganese and silicon. Okay, it is similar to your Bessemer converter. In Bessemer converters also, same thing we did, right? So when you are having sulfur and phosphorus, then you have to go for basic Bessemer converter. Similarly, here also, when you are having sulfur and phosphorus, you have to go for the basic open hearth process where your sulfur and phosphorus can be removed. Okay, if you see the acidic open hearth process once again, see. If you see the acidic open hearth process, the lining will be with acidic refractory material and charged with low content of sulfur. Just now I told you it should have low content of sulfur and phosphorus. Otherwise, we are unable to remove phosphorus and sulfur in acidic open hearth process. This sulfur and phosphorus can be removed only in basic open hearth process. So you can charge solid pig iron, followed by scrap. Before that, you have to add lime and steel scrap, all those things, iron ore, iron, first limestone, iron ore, steel scrap, and pig iron you have to add, and oxidation process will take place, and manganese oxide and silica will be formed. That means silicon and manganese can be eliminated in the oxides form. After that, the slag will be formed, it can be removed off. When desired amount of carbon remains in the bath, then what we have to do, we have to add the ferrosilicon, which controls the, which arrests the oxidation of carbon such that we should have required amount of carbon in the steel. Okay, so in this way, we are going for the acid open hearth process. So this is your acid open hearth process. And if you are having phosphorus and sulfur more in content in the charge, then you have to go for the basic open hearth process. In the basic open hearth process, so the lining will be basic, the refractory lining will be with the basic refractory material, and here we can eliminate the impurities like manganese silicon as well as sulfur and phosphorus. So it is similar to your basic Bessemer converter. Okay, so the whatever the seed we are getting from this, your basic open hearth furnace is having good characteristics compared to your acidic open hearth furnace, and this steel is used for girders, for making of girders, wires, ropes, and other general structural applications. For all structural applications, we can use this basic open hearth steel. Okay, so this is basic open hearth steel. If you go for the summary, what we have discussed, see here. So what we have discussed, so in this session, what we have discussed, what is open hearth furnace? See, open hearth process and preheated, what is meant by preheat and what is meant by regeneration. Okay, iron oxide and oxidizing impurities, so we are removing the impurities by oxidation method, and discussed detailed features and working principle of open hearth furnace, how the process will take place, whether it is acidic open hearth process or basic open hearth process. Okay, so how the process will take place and what is the sequence of charging of the charge. Okay, so first one, lime should be charged, later we have to add iron ore, and next steel scrap, after that pig iron should be added. So in this way, you have to add the charge and what are the operations that will take place, and how manganese and silicon are eliminated, and later how sulfur and phosphorus are eliminated, and what is meant by ore boil. All these things we have discussed in this session, and discuss about the features and working principle of acid and basic open hearth process. Okay, so this one is very, very important. They will ask generally, what is the difference between acidic open hearth process and basic open hearth process? So you are able to differentiate the two processes. Okay, so this is the summary what we have learned in this session. And if you go for the quizzes, if you see the quiz, see, basic open hearth furnace is used for the production of basic open hearth furnace. So in the application part, we have discussed generally the structure for the structural applications, this basic open hearth furnace still is used. Why? Because in this one, you are having the removal of sulfur and phosphorus. So when you are having sulfur and phosphorus more in the charge, then it can be removed by using only basic open hearth furnace. So by using this basic open hearth furnace only, we can remove the sulfur and phosphorus. So structural components, all the structural components like girders, wire, ropes, and structural purposes can be used by steel from basic open hearth furnace. Acid open hearth furnace is used for the production of high grade steel. Okay, so there your phosphorus and sulfur are less, and only silicon and manganese can be removed off, and you are going to get this high grade steel. Okay, so what are the frequently questions generally they will ask? See here, describe the process of making open hearth process with a neat sketch. So with a neat sketch, you have to be able to explain how the construction and operation, everything you have to explain. It is a long question. Okay, diagram, constructional details, operation, and any reactions, and what you are going to get, everything you have to write, important points, all the important points you have to mention to get good marks. And compare the methods of making a Bessemer and open hearth furnace. So Bessemer converter, how the steel will be made in a Bessemer converter, and how is the steel will be made in a open hearth furnace. So you know the process of Bessemer process, and also just now we have discussed the open hearth furnace process. So you have to mention, so how the steel will be made in the Bessemer converter process, and how the steel will be made in the open hearth furnace process. So you have to write these two processes, then you can answer. That means you have to compare how it will be made and how it will be made. So you can compare and you can write this Bessemer converter process and the open hearth furnace process. Okay, so with this one, I am closing today's session.